Good evening from the beautiful city of Georgetown, Guyana. Thank you for joining us tonight. From whichever time zone you are joining us, welcome to Bible study. We do apologize for the late start. This was due to some technical difficulties we experienced. Nonetheless, we are grateful for our technicians, our brothers behind the scene who work tirelessly to ensure that we are up and running. Thank you for staying with us tonight. It is a joy to have you. If you're happy to be with us, if you're happy to study the Word of God with us as we are, I want you to type "Thank you, Jesus" in the chat. Hallelujah. You know, today I shared the photograph of the little baby that was pulled from the rubble in the earthquake that really devastated parts of Turkey and parts of Syria. I shared that photograph on a Facebook post. And you know, in Guyanese parlance, we would say a lil water baby. You know, just to see the miracle working power of our God. In the midst of disaster, destruction, death, there are signs of hope. And something about the children that is really touching my heart, even as I look at this devastation, and our hearts really go out to the people of Turkey and of Syria that are going through so much right now. Our prayers are with you, and we pray that relief will come very, very soon. The basic food and water and so on, we're trusting God that that will come through for you in very timely manner. But my heart was so encouraged today as I shared that Facebook post of the miracle working power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In the midst of that situation, there is life. And this tells me that notwithstanding our circumstances, no matter how bad it is, no matter how adverse it is, purpose will keep us alive. I want somebody to type that in the chat. Purpose will keep us alive. And so let us continue to pray for that little baby. She's orphaned. But the same God that kept her alive, the same God will provide for her. And so tonight, we want to continue studying the Word of God, the one who is, the one who was, the one who is to come. We want to talk about him tonight as we continue to study the book of Revelation. Greetings again to all our Facebook viewers, especially, and our YouTubers. We are grateful that you are with us. So in the interest of time, we want to go straight into our study. And please help me welcome at this time, Reverend Anthony Semple. God bless you. Stay with us.
Good evening to you, one and all. Praise God. Thank you very much, Pastor Paul. And we are so grateful to God that we are here. Thank you once again. I echo the words of Pastor Paul. Thank you for staying with us. And it's amazing how these things happen from time to time. But we want to bless God that we have a very efficient technical team. You know, they are really on the ball, and we want to bless God for them in the midst of everything. Amen. I definitely concur with you, Pastor Paul. It's amazing how that child survived, you know, and we really want to bless God for that sign of hope in the midst of devastation in Turkey. Let's give God praise for what we have here. We thank God for sparing us of these natural disasters this side of the world, while we continue to remember those who experience challenges all over the world. We are so many feet below sea level, and it's only the grace of God. Every now and again, we would have a little tremor to remind us that He is on the throne. Sometimes we have thunder and lightning and some rain. You know, I don't believe we don't have anything, you know, that could really throw us in a different direction. And we want to really bless God for that. But nonetheless, let's continue to remember our brethren all over the world in prayer. Amen. So God bless you. We're looking forward for this study tonight. Blessings one and all, you and the entire family. Thank you for inviting us into your space. And we declare the blessings of the Lord. We declare the anointing of the Holy Spirit all over that space that you're occupying right now. If you're in a home, everywhere in your house, we apply the blood of Jesus. And we say shalom, a complete package of peace of God in your homes and in your space. Amen. Welcome to Dr. Wilbert Arlington Lee. Bless you, sir.
Reverend Semple, and good evening, everyone, wherever you might be joining us. And again, I'm happy that both yourself and Pastor Benjamin stressed the fact that there is hope, you know, in the midst of that disaster there. They are still finding people who are alive. And I remember in our own disaster that we had going back to 2005, the international community reached out and helped us. So we can pray for Turkey. There's that earthquake, then there is winter. And so our thoughts and our prayers go to that people. As we go through the book of Revelation, and then Turkey is important too, because as we study the book of Revelation, John pointed to the seven churches, and those seven churches were located in what we call present-day Turkey. So it's quite fitting that we extend our heartfelt sympathy, our empathy with those people as we study the book of Revelation. And as we go through the study tonight, I want to encourage us that God has not left us without a witness. In the book of 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3, it says verse 16 to 17 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Verse 17 says, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So as we go through the book of Revelation, we go through the study, we all should be reminded that God has given us a witness. God has not left us without a witness of the things He intends to do. And so Revelation tells us what will happen in the last days. So join us tonight and let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you tonight. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for the privilege. Thank you, God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit that you promised and that you have given. Your Holy Spirit who would lead, guide, and direct us into all truth. So tonight we pray for the presence of your Holy Spirit, not only among Reverend Semple, Pastor Benjamin, and myself, but for all our listeners, all our viewers, those who are on their way to work, those who are in their homes, those who are in vehicles. We pray, God, that you'll touch them, O God, those who are believing you for transformation, those who are believing you for a breakthrough, those who are believing you for touching their bodies, those who are believing you, O God, for opportunities. We pray tonight, God, that you'll undertake in a special way. And as we study your word, we pray that it will bring life, hope, joy, and peace into our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you again, brethren, and we are still in Revelation chapter 1. And, you know, last week we looked at, we did a bit of historical background. We traced the fact that we talked about Patmos. We talked about why John was sent there. We talked about the fact that despite the difficult circumstances we find ourselves in, the purposes of God will always be fulfilled. So sometimes, you know, we tend to complain about the difficulties that we're going through. But here, this man, John, was on the island of Patmos. And he was the only fruitful thing there, really, in an island that was not fruitful. But God looked down. And despite all that was happening, all those who were on the island there, God saw his faithful servant, John. So despite what you were going through, God is seeing you. And God is on your side. So as we went through the early verses of that, I want to point to an important word that is used in verse 1. It says, God gave him to show. The word show. Show speaks to the fact that God has not left us without a witness. Show speaks to the fact that God is concerned about us. Show speaks to the fact that God wants to establish, maintain, and to cement a relationship with us. So God has not hidden anything from us that will happen in the last days. God has shown it to his servant. So as we go through the book, while it might be filled with symbols and signs, it is not, you know, as we might say, it is difficult to understand, because not many persons often study the book of Revelation because of the symbols, the sign, because of the catastrophic events that it will mention. But with the word of God, we are not necessarily called to understand, because verse 3 tells us that we are blessed, those of us who read it and those of us who abide by it. So simply reading it, it didn't say that those who understand it. And you know, sometimes we use our own finite mind to understand the word of God, but God has given us his Holy Spirit that will reveal through to us. So this word of God says there's a blessing to those who read it. It didn't say understand. So God has shown us what will happen in the end times, what will happen in the last days, and we have a blessing simply by reading it and adhering to it. So be encouraged. And so tonight we will continue the study, and I just read a few verses before I invite my brothers to continue. I'll read from verse 2. Verse 2 says, who testify, I'm reading the NIV, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the word of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. Verse 4 says, John to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, from the seven spirits before the throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Grace and peace. You know, John give the traditional salutation there, grace and peace. Grace and peace encompasses, or grace and peace encompass our whole Christian walk. The Bible tells us, by grace are ye saved through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Peace, the word of God tells us that Jesus Christ gives peace, not as the world gives. So our whole Christian walk encompass grace on one hand, which is salvation that God has given us through the blood of Jesus Christ, and peace, which only the Lord can give. Not peace that, you know, we consider the absence of war, but the peace that we have inside of us, despite the difficult circumstance. So John salutes the church by pointing to two important aspects of our Christian walk: grace and peace. And tonight, we say also grace and peace to you, brethren, reminding you that we have salvation in no other name but in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And peace, not as the world gives, but only that Jesus can give. Bless you, brethren.
Amen. Beautiful, Dr. Lee. Grace and peace. Accept with much love and joy.
Amen.
Oh, fruits of the Spirit. Hallelujah. What a great joy it is. You know, as you spoke about verse 2, as you read verse 2, you know, that started by saying, who testifies to everything he saw? To my mind, John is setting an important precedence here, especially as it relates to prophecy. As we know, prophecy not only includes not only foretelling the future, but also proclaiming the word of God. Proclaiming the word of God, whether it is in command, whether it's in instruction, you know, whether it's in history or prediction, we are proclaiming the word of God. And whenever we proclaim the word of God, we must do as the word of God says. Testify to everything we see and we hear from God. So it's very important. And as we continue to delve into these verses, what a blessing it is when we look at verse 3. Blessed is the one who reads it. It didn't say blessed is the Christian. Blessed is the one. This is an invitation to anyone, to everyone, to all and sundry. There is a blessing in reading the word of God, reading it aloud. You know, when we look at the word blessed, some people, when we give a greeting to them, you know, they would respond and they would say, I am blessed and highly favored. And it's a very good response. I like it. But it is important for us to delve into its true meaning. And when we look at the first blessing here, this is the first of seven Beatitudes in this book of Revelation. And when we look at the word blessed, it means more than happiness. It means more than being happy. It really describes the favorable circumstances granted by God to us, to a person. Isn't God good? Somebody needs to say, thank you, Jesus, for your blessings over our lives. You know, happiness is an emotion that, you know, often dependent on external circumstances, outward circumstances. But blessed here is referring to the ultimate well-being, the total package. Hallelujah. You see, God is not just concerned with circumstances, but he is concerned with the total package, our total well-being. And really the distinctive joy of those who share in the salvation of the kingdom of God. We are blessed to be called children of God. And so tonight, we want to encourage you, know you're blessed, know you're highly favored, know that there is a blessing. And every time we read the word, every time we proclaim the word of God, there is a blessing upon our life.
Pastor Paul,
yes.
I'm thinking that the word of God includes everyone. Blessed is he. It says, blessed is he that read it. And they that hear. It's amazing how that distinction. he being singular and that read it, and they that hear being plural. It's amazing about the play of those words. So just in case you might not be able to read it, you know, because of some challenge somewhere along the line, let's say you're blind, you can't see, all right, we know we got Braille and so on, but not everybody really into that. So you're not left out just in case you can't see to read. You could hear it. So I thought that was really interesting how that is set up so that everybody could receive this blessing. You just got to put yourself in place to really receive this word. But I just want to back up the verse too a little because of some of the things that are mentioned here. It says, speaking of the Apostle John that we spoke about last week, who bear record of the word of God. So he kind of was a witness to the word of God and of the testimony of Christ and of all things that he saw. And of course, this is Revelation. Lots of things were revealed to the Apostle John. And I just got to thinking about this. This man was really entrusted. He was trusted with so much revelation. And he had to be a good steward in order to for God to place these things into his care. You know, on Choices, over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about the whole question of stewardship. And you could clearly see that John here was a good steward, because we are benefiting. We are able to look at the word, read the word, listen to the word. He painstakingly wrote this down. And I'm thinking, you know, could God trust us like this? Could God trust you? Could God trust me, you know, to give the precious word of God to us so that we could disseminate, so that we can share? Could we bear record? Could we be trusted with the mysteries of the word of God? You know, and that is very thought-provoking. John must have been in a particular place for him to be trusted like this. And I'm saying, God, help me to be somebody. You know, I'm still a work in progress. I don't know about you, but I'm asking God, Lord, help me to be somebody that you can trust. You can give the treasures and the mysteries of your word, and I faithfully disseminate. You know, and it's very interesting. And the fact too that it says, who bear record, verse 2, of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. All things that he saw. This is very interesting. I know Dr. Legan Wayne and this and Pastor Paul, but not some things. And no, you know, as a record keeper, there's not everything that you see or hear you may want to feel inclined to write. You know, and so I'm just thinking, John, God knew that he could trust John to write everything. He's going to see some things. He's going to hear some things that he might be able to say, man, you know what? I didn't want to write that. And as a matter of fact, later down as we go down in other chapters, we're going to see John is so faithful that a particular time he heard a voice saying, do not write. So it's not just to be ready to write, but really is to be ready to obey whatever instruction that you would receive. So there was a time when he had to write, and there was a time when he had not to write. So it's amazing how all of these things are set, and all, in this case, all he bore record of all the things that he saw. And even as I was thinking about this afternoon, I thought about a game that we used to play. I don't know if you remember this game. Where someone would whisper something in someone's ears, a phrase, and you want to see how best this phrase is going to be kept. I sure some of you smiling now because you remember playing that game. Well, last we played a game, perhaps we got played some one these days to refresh our memory of how things could be lost, you know. And you speak a phrase in someone's ears, and then you ask them to say the identical thing to the next person, and then the other person gonna say to the next person. You remember the game? And then after like 10 or 15 persons, we want to see how the thing gonna come out at the end. And trust me, every time I play that game, at the coming out at the end, is something totally different from what it started with, you know. But thank God that John wasn't somebody like this, you know. He heard, he saw, and he replicated exactly, by the grace of God, what was given to him. So this is interesting. And so we have a credible witness. We have a credible life vessel. We could know with all surety that what we're reading and what we're hearing is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help us God. Amen.
Simple. Context. You know, Dr. Lee can really share with us as a communications specialist. I think it's testing the whole communication process of encoding and decoding a message and getting feedback and so on. So those things, that process is very important. And you are amazed to see the kind of messages, the feedback you would get. But, you know, as we are studying and as we are looking at verse 2, you know, Reverend Semple, as you spoke about the importance of John recording, I mean, let us look at the what he is recording. He is recording the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. To my mind, the two goes hand in glove. They are inseparable. The Word of God is the testimony of Jesus Christ. And so very, very important for us to understand that as we write, we must write as God gives the revelation. And God is reiterating the value and the importance of the Word of God. The scripture declares that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So that is the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's the Word of God becoming flesh. And so these are doctrinal truths. These are foundational principles of our Christian faith and our Christian walk. And so let us ensure that we understand, let us depend on the Holy Spirit to help us to understand these principles, because here again, the final book of the Bible, God is reiterating the importance of the Word of God becoming flesh, the importance of the testimony of Jesus Christ, who is that Word becoming flesh. And I love the Message Bible, how it puts it, moving into the neighborhood, becoming incarnational. And as leaders, as people of salt, and light, we have to become what God wants us to become in our communities and shine that light. Amen.
There's an important lesson we can learn also from what is written here. John, in modern day context, you know, we refer to the editor of a newscast, the editor of a newspaper, who takes out what he or she considers unimportant, or might have, or presented a different perspective. But John was not an editor here. John wrote what he was told to write. And so we have the recording here. And it's important to understand that, because sometimes in our own Christian walk, sometimes we are guilty of editing what, you know, we feel may not be, well, it rubs us the wrong way, or, you know, we feel convicted or convinced by the Holy Spirit that what we're doing is incorrect. And, you know, sometimes we say, you know, the Spirit didn't witness to me, so I don't feel it. And, you know, persons might be telling us, but John made a note that he recorded everything that he saw and everything he heard. And verse 3 is connected to that, because verse 3 starts with the singular, referring to the one. In some translation, he. And so it moves from the singular and it goes to the plural. It moves from the one who reads aloud the word of this prophecy, and blessed are those. So it moves from he, it moves from one, it moves from those. So it moves from the singular person, it moves to the congregation, or it moves to the crowd. And it reminds us, you know, when we did the book of Nehemiah, there was public reading and was read by one person, assisted by others, and then there was explanation. So here we have where the scripture is telling us, encouraging us to read. Why we should read it? Because it's God's word. It's not John's imagination. John was shown it and he recorded it. So that's important. The other thing that is mentioned here, apart from those who hear it, but it says that those who take to heart what is written. So again, John is not just providing us with information as to what will happen in the end time. You know, there's quite a lot of information going wrong. Facebook, WhatsApp, and all of that. Quite a lot of information. But how many of us, or how much of that information is true? How much of it is trustworthy? So look at the last part of verse 3. The second to last part. He says, and who hears it and take to heart what is written. So it's information plus how we should live our lives in the last days. So we have both information as to what was happened, but more importantly for us as Christians is that we take heed to what is written so that our lives can be in conformity to the word of God. So while there's blessing for the individual, there's blessing for those who hear it, John quickly undergirds it. He quickly underscores it by saying that we must take to heart what is written. So again, Revelation is not just prophetic. It's not just telling us what will happen in times. We call it eschatology. It's not only telling us about what will happen, but importantly, the last book in the Bible reminds us how we should live, how we should conduct our lives, how we should conduct ourselves. Why? Because the end is near.
And Dr. Lee, if I can just quickly add, as you were talking there, Joshua chapter 1 verse 8 came to mind. It is so critical for us to internalize the word of God, because it does something to our heart that will effect change, that will cause us to move in a particular direction that God wants us to do. And so we find in Joshua chapter 1 verse 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth. We can only keep it in our mouths if we meditate on it, if we internalize it, as we are encouraged here, if we take it to heart according to the word of God. It says, but thou shalt meditate therein when? Day and night. Hallelujah. That thou mayest observe to do. That is what we do when we internalize the word of God. We will observe to do it according to all that is written therein. Yes, for then shalt thou make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So we have the formula here for good success. When we read the word of God, when we hear the word of God, when we take it to heart and we meditate on it day and night, our ways will be prosperous. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen. The word of God, hearing and meditating on the word. It's amazing how that is. You know, I thought we would have gone a little further tonight, but, you know, This is the nature of the word of God. When you start to chew, you just want to chew and stay there. That's right. Oh boy. And so I just want to bear with me as I want to just fast track a little. Gentlemen, please forgive me, but this thing is so sweet that I had to fast track to chapter 22. You can imagine that. We done at the end of the book already, but you're gonna see where we're going with this. Verse 3 of chapter 1 says, blessed is he that readeth and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. Now, so since we're dealing with the blessing of those that are reading it, since we're dealing with the blessing of those that hear, chapter 22 says something that we should really, I believe we should put side by side with what we're seeing in chapter 1, verse 3. So look at chapter 22, verse 18 and 19. Since we're hearing and we're reading, it says, for I testify unto thee, unto every man that heareth the words of this prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. We don't want to delve into all of those things yet. Of course, when we reach there, we're going to talk about it. But it makes good reading and good balancing between what we saw in verse 3 of chapter 1 and verses 18 and 19 of Revelation chapter 22. And this also underscores the fact that God is throwing his weight behind John. You know, the credibility of this book, the accuracy, the unerring accuracy of this book, so much that if anything is added to this, it's like, this is it. You know, we got to say, this is it. We can leave it alone. This is it, right? There's nothing else that you need to add to this. And we live in a day and age where, you know, people prophesying all kinds of things. They're prophesying. And got lots of prophets, P-R-O-F-I-T-S. All right? And hey, this is so clear. Anybody add? Anybody take away? You're going to be dealt with condignly and accordingly according to this. This is how important and this is how serious God takes his word, because nobody should be left without an excuse. Nobody should be able to say, well, I didn't know about what's happening here. It's plain, and the Lord allowed John to express everything in full. And this is the complete package. Amen. Praise God.
Amen. You know, Pastor Semple, yes, as a matter of fact, in the same Revelation 22, verse 7, mm-hmm. talks about another beatitude. I am coming soon. Blessed are those who keep the prophetic message in this book. So we are not to add or to take away, but we are to keep. We are to take it to heart. Hallelujah. So even as we close, keep the promises of God over your heart and your life. Keep the word of God. Let it continue to be that modus operandi. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I know Dr. Lee is rearing and ready to go with our time is gone.
Ready to close.
Amen.
Amen.
And you know, I certainly agree with you, Pastor Benjamin, because John records, you know, the following verses mention he who was, who is, who was, and is to come.
It's not
a God that was created just for the book of Revelation. It's not a God that who just came on the scene. It speaks to his the fact that he's eternal. He rules in the past, he rules in the present, and he rules in the future. And so it's important that we recognize that the God we serve, you know, he has this entire, we mustn't just sing the song, he has the whole world in his hands. but we must believe it, that he is in control of every aspect of our lives. Everything that happens in this world happens because God allows it to happen, and God is in control.
Amen.
So despite what you might be going through, brothers and sisters, let's close out this broadcast by reminding ourselves that God is, God was, and God is to come. God bless you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Thank you very much.
Hallelujah.
Gentlemen, it's always a pleasure being in Bible study. Never mind, we had a little late start. I believe we made up for the kind of start that we had. Thank God for helping us. And we want to continue to bless God. Thank you again for staying with us. Thank you for coming in.
Yes.
When you actually share the link, and we bless God for all of you on Facebook, on YouTube. We really thank God that you were able to be in. Trust that you were able to glean something from the Word of God. And the Word of God will continue to be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Amen.
Yeah.
We want to, at this time, we want to commiserate with our sister and minister, Shireen David, who would have lost her brother. It's not an easy thing to lose a loved one, but we really want to ask the Lord to really touch her, not just her, but her entire family, her children, other siblings, and everyone associated with the family. And so we want to say that we are standing with you, a dear sister of ours. This is our choir director, Santry Choir Director. You would know Sister Penny. She gives us all the antics and everything when she's in front there leading. And so, but antics full of the Holy Spirit. Just let me make sure I see that.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. So God bless you. Thank you very much for being here with us again. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom. Bless you, Bishop, on your assignment. May the Lord continue to strengthen you too, and your family at home and all abroad, I should say. God bless you. Have a great night, everyone.
Amen. Bye. Amen. Bless you.
I've seen it in a hospital room when the doctor said sorry. There's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said it, you'll perform it. May not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you.